Good morning, everyone. Here we are in the third day of the spiritual retreat. And today's talk is on anger. Before I introduce today's speaker, let us establish some rules for asking questions. This talk is very, very interactive, but the interaction also depends on the way you listen and the kind of questions you ask. So you are free to send the questions on chat box, but have patience. Don't be impatient if the question is not answered immediately. There'll be breaks in between where ma'am will be taking up the questions, right? So don't feel your question is not being taken up and you have to repeat it. You don't have to repeat. It will be noticed by me and it will be put up every now and then in intervals whenever we feel we can give a break in between. But you must ask and you must listen. And children, it is a very, very well prepared talk which has a lot of pictures, a beautifully designed PPT, and you will really enjoy looking at them. So my request to all of you is keep those in mind. You know, the visual impact is such that it remains in the mind longer. So if you keep those pictures in mind and reflect upon them, automatically all that is being said today will keep coming to your memory. It will be easier for you to remember. So when you look at the picture, you can reflect upon it, think about it, and then hear the talk, and then frame your questions. Internalize and frame your questions. Also, as always, I'm very sure you'll be very, very decent while sending the questions in the chat box. I have a very beautiful experience. I've been noticing these last 2 days that your questions are very good and your language is also very, very polite. So all of us will maintain the same status. We all know our vice chairperson, Mrs. Anjali Jaipuria. She's much, much revered in the school. But there are people who are not students and teachers who are also there. So brief introduction about ma'am. Mrs. Anjali Jaipuria, the vice chairperson of Seth Hemar Jaipuria School, is an educationist with a vision for fundamental change in the Indian educational system. She combines her love for Vedic wisdom and its relationship with the needs of economic, social, and political conditions of today, creating contemporary learning materials. And every Jaipurian can vouch for that. We all are a witness of this. She studies Sri Aurobindo's and the Mother's evolutionary work, integral yoga, and educational reform, the Vedas, the Upanishads, and the Bhagavad Gita. She has been teaching the Bhagavad Gita in the light of Sri Aurobindo to a group of aspirants since 2015. She is the vice chairperson of the Integral Education Society, which runs the school. And at present, the school has more than 4,200 students. But this is not all. Ma'am also runs a school, Navsrijan, which all students and teachers know of. She is the president of this school. And she began this school to fulfill her dream of giving level playing field for all children. It began in 2003. It is an English medium school for the underserved, imparting the same education as Seth Hemar Jaipuria School. There are 300 students in this school at present. And ma'am visualizes to have as many students as we have in Jaipuria School in Navsrijan School. It is a matter of pride for all of us that the principal of Navsrijan School, Mrs. Asha Chadda, is also here with us today. And this year, the children will be appearing for the board exam as well, NIOS. We've registered for that. These children are living on the margins of poverty. And this initiative is done besides the RTE mandate of the government for the mainstream school. Entered and win accolades in so many inter-school competitions in Lucknow. They've beaten the most prominent schools of Lucknow in so many competitions in creative writing, elocutions, and debates. Ma'am is also the honorary managing trustee of Mother's Institute of Research, which pioneers research work in Sri Aurobindo's and Mother's evolutionary work and integral yoga and in educational reforms that aim at a fundamental change in the present educational system of India. And the audience here is already aware that schools in India do not take care of psychic or spiritual education. So this is an educational reform which Setham Arjapuriya looks at. And as you move through the talk, you'll realize how much insight children have. It is just that we have to give them this opportunity. Ma'am has also presented a variety of papers. The list is long. I cannot read the entire list here, but to name a few. Who is Mother India at Rotary Club, Mumbai in 2013? On the Divine Feminine Shakti at GPIW Summit, Jaipur. On Evolution at Ramjas School, New Delhi, 2012. On Mahavakya of the Gita. You have to study the Gita to think and to speak about the Mahavakya of the Gita. On the Soul, Teacher Training, Delhi, 2012. On Harmonizing Relations, Monastery, Taiwan, 2010. On the Soul of Indian Art, so you can understand the diversity the vice chairperson has, speaking about spirituality, not religion, the Bhagavad Gita, the Vedas, and here comes art. At a seminar on philosophy of Indian art at National Museum, New Delhi. On the synopsis of the Bhagavad Gita, Modi Foundation. On mantric poetry at Trivandrum, 2003. I must add, ma'am writes beautiful poetry and she devotes it to Lord Krishna. She writes for her. On peace at UNO Global Peace Initiative by Women, Geneva, 2002. On Vedas, Evolution and Sri Aurobindo at University of Massachusetts, USA, 2002. Ma'am has done her Bachelor's of Science in Economics from Lady Sri Ram College in New Delhi. There is a lot more to add, but time is short. So with this, I welcome our Vice Chairperson, Mrs. Anjali Jaipuriya, to begin the interaction on anger. Thank you very much. Ma'am, your turn.
So my dear students and teachers, today we are going to be discussing anger. It's one big problem that most of us face or we are trying to deal with. Now, what is anger? Gussa hai kya? Kai log bolte hain, many people say gussa kisi ki galti ki saza khud ko dena hai. But I don't agree with that. When I am angry, it is my mistake. Whatever somebody else may have done. If I am angry, I have lost my cool. So the problem lies with me. Whatever somebody else may have done, I could have remained calm. I could have remained in a state of equanimity, which we'll talk about in the afternoon. So the problem, if I'm losing my cool, I'm losing my anger, the problem lies with me. This we must understand. Lord Buddha said something very beautiful. He said, holding on to anger is like grasping a hot coal with the intent of throwing it at someone else. And you are the one who gets burned. So we suffer when we get angry. We are the ones who lose out. Let me tell you a story. A snake once penetrated into a carpentry workshop. As it slipped, it passed over a saw. And as it passed over the saw, it got slightly wounded. When it got wounded, it turned and bit the saw in anger. Now, if you have a saw in your mouth, you can understand what happened to the snake's mouth. The snake's mouth started bleeding. He got more furious. And he said, I'm going to crush this saw. And he wrapped himself like snakes do around the saw, that I'm going to crush this saw. And the snake got killed. So what happens when we get angry? We must remember, it is myself that I hurt most when I lose my cool, when I get angry. You see, the food that we eat has to be digested and it has to be thrown out of our system within 24 hours or else we get sick. The water that we drink, it has to be evacuated from the system within 4 hours or else we get sick. The air that we breathe, within 1 minute, it's evacuated and fresh air comes in. Or else the passages, the air passages don't remain very healthy. What about negative emotions like anger, hatred, jealousy, insecurity, fear? If they stay inside our body, what is going to happen to our body? What happens to our body is we start getting psychosomatic diseases. So we have to be very careful that we do not harbor these emotions inside us, these negative emotions inside us. Otherwise, we have the risk of getting angry, getting ill and sick, and our body starts getting sick also. Coming to the negative emotion which we are going to deal with today, anger. So let's begin with a little slide, small slide from a movie, Inside Out. Has anybody here seen this movie about emotions? Thumbs up by those who have seen. Yeah, let's see some more thumbs ups. Oh, so a lot of people have seen this movie.
Here we go. All right, open.
This looks new.
Think it's safe?
What is it?
Okay, caution. There is a dangerous smell, people. Hold on, what is that?
This is disgust. She basically keeps Riley from being poisoned. Physically and socially.
That is not brightly colored or shaped like a dinosaur. Hold on, guys. It's broccoli! Yucky!
Well, I just saved our lives. Yeah, you're welcome.
Riley, if you don't eat your dinner, you're not gonna get any dessert.
Wait, did he just say we couldn't have dessert?
That's anger. He cares very deeply about things being fair.
So that's how you wanna play it, old man? No dessert? Oh, sure. We'll eat our dinner right after you eat this.
Right, here comes an airplane.
Oh, airplane. We got an airplane, everybody.
Now, let's understand what is anger. Anger, sometimes we believe that the anger is coming from inside me. But anger is actually a rush of force which is coming from outside, from the universal nature. And when the anger comes from the universal nature, the mind actually tunes into negative emotions. And when the mind is tuned to negative emotions, it picks up the negative emotions from outside, subjectifies it, and we start feeling that the anger is actually coming from within me. The whole problem is that we have not been told that our mind is like a radio. Our mind is like a radio. Now, when you, in our times, we used to hear a lot of radio. You guys go to YouTube, so I don't know how much radio you hear. But when you turn the radio on to shortwave, you pick up anything that's being played on shortwave. When you tune the radio to FM or to Radio Mirchi, you hear Radio Mirchi or you hear FM, whatever you are tuned to. Right? And when you hear that music, you feel that it's coming out of the radio. But actually, what is the radio doing? The radio is actually picking up the waves from outside and letting it flow from inside. Similarly, we in our mind, if I am tuned to positive thoughts, if I am tuned to my psychic being, to my soul within, if I am tuned to positive emotions, all the positive emotions that are there in the universal nature, I will pick up the positive emotions and subjectify them. And I will, what will come out of me will be positive. Right? So anger, when I'm tuned to negative emotions, we pick up all the negative emotions and they play out of us as if they are my own. Now, it really helps when we try to deal with anger. It really helps when we know that it's coming from outside to push it out. It's much easier. There are two verses in the Gita which have spoken about anger and the effect of anger on us very, very clearly. Mona ma'am, can you show us? I think some of you students would be knowing those verses also because it is part of your Devabhasha curriculum. It's chapter 2, verse 62, and then we'll do verse 63. Dhyayato vishayan punsaha sangasteshu pajayate sangat sanjayate kamaha kamat krodho bhijayate. In him whose mind dwells on the objects of sense with absorbing interest, attachment to them is formed. From attachment arises desire. From desire, anger comes forth. Got it, children? First, the mind dwells on the objects of sense with absorbing interest that I want this object. And then an attachment is formed to that object of interest. And with the object, the attachment to the object of interest, desire forms. From desire, anger comes forth. Yes, ma'am, the next slide. Krodhat bhavati sammohaha. Sammohat smriti vibhramaha. Smriti bhranshad buddhinasho buddhinashad pranashyati. What does anger lead to? Anger leads to bewilderment. When we become completely confused, perplexed, from bewilderment comes loss of memory. And by that, the intelligence is destroyed. From destruction of intelligence, he perishes. Now let's see it in our normal life. Suppose we're going to be playing a football match. Now the object of sense is the first thing. The object of sense, my senses say, I want to win this football match. I want to win it for my house. And an attachment starts building up inside me. I want to win this football match. I want to be the man of the match. I want to be recognized for being the man of the match, to win the football match. Now the attachment has come. There is no more, I want to play for the sake of enjoying. It is, I want to play because I want to win this football match and I want to be the man of the match. I want to be honored. The desire has come up. And the desire is to score most of the goals. And that whenever anybody stops you from shooting your goal or somebody dribbles the ball away, I am angry. Why? Because I have a desire. I am not playing for the joy of the game. I am playing because I want to shoot most goals. I want to be the man of the match. Whenever anybody dribbles away the ball from me, I become angry. And then when you're angry and you shoot the goal towards the goalpost and the goalkeeper stops it, you become more angry. When you become more angry, you start becoming bewildered, confusion, perplexity. And there is loss of memory. What is the memory that you've lost? You've forgotten that I was playing the game because I wanted to enjoy the game. And now I'm playing the game only so I can shoot the most goals. I become the man of the match and my house wins. Everything else I've forgotten. So what has happened? Object of sense, attachment to that object of sense leads to desire. And when the desire is not fulfilled, it leads to anger. And when I have reached the stage of anger, what happens? Inside me, I'm bewildered. And there is loss of memory. I've forgotten the very aim for which I'm playing. And then I try, because I'm bewildered, now I've forgotten what I really should be playing for. And then I start trying every trick of the trade. I trip the person who's trying to dribble the ball. And I think the umpire is not watching. I shove somebody and I think the umpire is not watching. And I start doing all those things which are against the rules of the game. Because I have become bewildered and there is loss of memory. And then the Gita says, there is a destruction of my intelligence. It is my intelligence which tells me that I have to play like a sportsman. I have to build my sportsman spirit. I have to see, I mean, what is the umpire thinking about me? What is everybody? Am I playing like a sportsman? I've forgotten that. Destruction of my intelligence. And then he perishes. What perishes? The joy perishes. Because now people look down at me. You were cheating just to win. We didn't want that out of you. I start losing my friends. I start having people look at me as if I'm a cheat because I was cheating. So this is what anger really can lead to. And we are all aware of different situations of anger that we have gone through in life and what they have led to. Right? So we have come with 2 points. One, that anger is a negative emotion. If I'm tuned to negativity inside, I pick up like a radio, I pick up the negative force. And that negative force subjectifies and turns into either anger or disgust or jealousy or anything else. But the negative force is outside, the universal force, and I'm picking it up. Right? This is a very important point. Now, there are 2 kinds of anger. There is an unconscious anger and there is a conscious anger. Would somebody here like to tell me what is unconscious anger? Some hands up. Some hands. Can I see some hands who would like to tell me what is unconscious anger? What happens in unconscious anger?
Ma'am, unconscious anger is the anger which we get at some point of time and then we can't express it. So it remains in our mind and it bursts out anytime at the time when we are quiet, it comes back to us and then we want to express it.
Yes, it is not only that we are unconscious about the anger, and because we are unconscious about the anger, we become the anger. We become the anger. And when we become the anger comes out of me unconsciously. I'm not even conscious that I am anger. I am angry. I have become the anger. Yes, Artha.
And we are unaware of the anger coming into us.
Yes, we become unaware that anger has, I have picked up the negative force. The mind has subjectified it because I was in a negative space. And the mind has subjectified it. And I have started identifying myself with anger. Remember the aim of spiritual retreat? We said, who should we identify with? Who are we? Who am I? I am that psychic being inside me, that presence. I've forgotten all that. I have identified with anger. I've become anger. And I'm using blame and criticism and my righteousness. I am right and the other is wrong. Blame, criticism, righteousness. These are the tools that we use when we are very unconsciously angry. We have become anger. Right?
Ma'am, may I interrupt for a minute?
Yes, ma'am.
Here we have Devalina. Would you like to highlight? I am just highlighting the answer she's written. It is, anger is used unconsciously as a defense tool. And we end up pushing people away.
Yes, when we use anger, very good, Devlina. When we use anger as a tool and unconscious anger as a tool, then we push people away from us because they don't want to bear the brunt of that anger. And we have become anger. We are not conscious of it. Very good, Devlina.
And Akriti has written, it can be said that the anger which suddenly arises, we don't... reason for it. Now here we don't know the reason for it.
Yes. We don't know the reason. We are unconscious of the reason. We have picked it up from the universal nature and we have become unconscious of it and we are just letting it all come out of us. And generally later on, one realizes ki ye maine kya bol diya? Why did I speak like this? And it is best to be able to get back to the person and apologize. That would help to a certain extent, although some damage already has been done. Very nice, Devleena. And no, it was somebody
Akriti.
Very nice, Akriti. Any other comments, ma'am, that you would like to read out on unconscious anger?
Unconscious anger could also be a result of overthinking, leading to irritation.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's all unconsciousness. Now, we are not conscious of what's going on in my mind. I'm not conscious where I'm stabilized. I'm not stabilized in my inner higher self. When I'm stabilized, not stabilized, and I'm all over the place, I pick up the negative vibrations and they just take hold of me and I become angry. Very good. So this is unconscious anger. When we identify with the anger, we become the anger. Should we move on to what is conscious anger? What is conscious anger? In conscious anger, there is no outburst. There is no outburst. There is clarity that I am feeling angry. I am feeling upset. And then I allow that feeling of anger pass through my mind, pass through my vital being, pass through my body. I observe it. I observe it from a distance and I know that I am angry, but I am not allowing that anger to come out of me and give it any kind of expression. Conscious anger tells a person that there is something in me that is not doing me any good service. Something that is not aligned. There is something in me that needs to be eliminated from my being. And such people who start becoming conscious that I am feeling anger, I'm not going to let the outburst come out. I'm going to look at this anger and I'm going to let the anger pass through my being. But I will not allow the anger to burst out. I will not use blame, criticism, and my righteousness. I am the best. No, there is only the clarity that I have identified anger. I know I am angry. And I just work on the anger within my being. And believe you me, prayers help a lot. So conscious anger is that anger which we become aware of, but we don't let an outburst come out of it. We look at the anger and we allow the anger to pass through us. Does any child want to say something about conscious anger?
What is the root of anger? This is a question, ma'am. From
What is the root of anger? The root of anger is keeping my being tuned to negativity. When my being, which is my mind, is like a radio. And if my mind is tuned to negativity, it will pick up all the negative vibrations that are there in the universe. The universe is buzzing with positive vibrations and with negative. All that is buzzing all around us. Depending on where I am rooted, my mind is tuned to what I pick up the emotion. So that is why we keep talking in Jaipuria School. We keep talking about the psychic being, the soul within, the higher self within, and to keep offering what I'm doing to that psychic being so that I'm rooted here. I'm rooted in the higher self. I'm rooted in God himself. And then the mind, which is tuned to the psychic being, is also tuned to positive emotions. And the mind picks up only positive emotions from outside. So you understand where the root of anger is? It depends on where my mind is rooted. Where is my mind tuned? Right? Is it clear?
So Sarthak Agarwal, I hope your question is answered after what ma'am has just now said. He had asked, we are aware of the anger, but we are not able to control it. So how do we control?
We will come to that towards the end of the session, and it's not very far. So what happens that these negative forces and these positive forces, when we start progressing in our consciousness, when we start progressing in our consciousness and we try to become more and more positive, more and more towards the divine consciousness, we are growing, the forces of the lower nature, like we saw in the clip, anger, disgust, all these don't like it because their team is becoming smaller. Somebody from their team who used to be very open to anger and disgust has now started moving towards the divine consciousness, has started moving towards a positive consciousness. So whenever anybody moves towards a positive consciousness, these negative forces become stronger and stronger. And they create situations so that you would get into an anger or you would get into a situation which is negative. And that is the time that we have to become more and more conscious. That is my mind tuned to these negative forces? Is it picking up these negative forces? Or is my mind picking up positive forces? Where am I rooted? Am I rooted in my inner being, in my higher self? Then when I'm rooted in the higher self, the mind will be tuned to positive emotions. This is a very, very important point to understand. Let me tell you a story. Once Krishna and Balram were looking after their, kingdom, and they strolled into the forest. When they reached the forest, and while they were looking at the people who were also living in the forest, the sun had come down, it had become dark, and they realized that they couldn't return home that day. So they decided that let's sleep in this cave for the night, let the night pass. And because there was two of them, they decided half the night, one person will sit outside and guard the cave while the other person will be inside the cave, sleeping, resting. And since Balram was the elder brother, he decided to become the first watch. And Krishna went into the cave to sleep while Balram, and Balram, big, strong man who knows he's very strong. So he held all his weapons aloft, and Krishna went to sleep inside. After an hour and a half, Balram sees a little dwarf coming towards him. So Balram says, "Stop, where are you going? And what are you doing here?" So the dwarf says, "You can see, I'm so small. I cannot harm you. You are a 6-footer, I'm just a dwarf. So just for the sake of entertainment, I want to do some kushti with you. I want to do some fighting with you. So will you agree to fight with me?" So Balram thought, "This little dwarf, I am 6 foot tall. It'll take me no time." He said, "Okay, let's have a fight." And the more Balram fought, the larger the dwarf became. And then more Balram fought with anger, more the dwarf became taller. Till the dwarf became so big that he tied up Balram with a rope, left him there and went away. Now after half the night was over, Krishna came out. When Krishna came out, he saw Balram, his elder brother, his 6 foot tall brother, lying on the floor. So he said, "What happened? I don't understand what happened." So Balram told him the whole story, that this little dwarf came and I thought, no problem, I can fight him. There's no problem at all. But the more I fought, the bigger he became. And finally, I became like a little child in front of him and he tied me. So Krishna said, no problem. He untied his elder brother. And he said, "Okay, Balram bhaiya, thou, now you go and sleep. And rest, you need rest more than I do. I'm going to watch guard." Krishna came out. Now Krishna came out, and after a little time, the dwarf came again. He says, Krishna asks, "What brings you here? Why are you here?" He says, "Thodi si kushti karni hai." just want to do a little bit of fighting with you. I enjoy fighting. You are huge. I'm just a dwarf. Krishna thought, let me entertain him for some time. So in the beginning, he just did a punch or two with him. And after that, when he saw the dwarf is growing bigger, he just sat down. And he said, I don't want to fight. The dwarf said, get up. Have you lost the battle? Get up, fight with me. Krishna says, I don't want to fight. And he just kept sitting. The more he kept quiet and calm, the dwarf became smaller and smaller and smaller. And he became so small that Krishna caught him in his pitambari and tied him up at the edge of it and kept him there. Now when Balram came out, Balram said, that did the dwarf come to you also, Krishna? He said, yeah, he came. He said, what did you do? He said, first have a look at the dwarf. And he showed him the pitambari. He said, it's tied up inside this. It becomes smaller than he was. So Balram said, how did you do that? Krishna said, I recognized this was anger. This was the force of anger that had come. And I knew that the more I become angry, the bigger the anger will become. So I just kept quiet and I connected with my higher self inside. And I kept connecting with my higher self. I got rooted in my higher self, in the psychic being inside me, in that flame, in that light. And the more I connected there, the dwarf became smaller and smaller and smaller until I could just tie him up in my pitambari. So Balram said, oh, if I would have recognized that this was not an ordinary dwarf, this was anger, I should have also done the same thing. But I'm glad, Krishna, you've told me. From next time, I'm going to be conscious when anger starts swelling up inside me. I won't let unconscious anger take hold of me. I will not identify myself with anger. I will become quiet and consciously I will look at anger and let it pass through my whole being. So here I'd like to ask you a question. Will giving expression to anger will that help in getting rid of the impulse of anger? Can somebody answer that? Sarthak says no, Maitri says no, Anusha says no. Does anybody here feel that giving expression to my anger, hamare andar bhara hua hai, usko nikalne do, khali ho jayega? Does anybody feel like that? That when I give expression to anger, it will empty out? No. So we have many, many, many conscious children in our school. Everybody is saying no. Why? Because when we give expression to anger, we prolong the habit of recurrence. Once we've gotten angry, we don't diminish the anger. We do not diminish the anger. The anger becomes like a habit, that some provocation from outside or some desire that is unfulfilled from inside, and I burst out. And once I do it, it becomes more of a habit, till it becomes like a continuous habit which I have no control of, and it becomes an unconscious anger. Did giving expression to anger help Balram? No. So it becomes a provocative nature. Now, what has the mother spoken about it? So somebody asked the mother, should we give expression to our anger? And the mother said, if you give expression to anger, you prolong or confirm the habit of the recurrence of anger. You do not diminish it. You do not get rid of the anger. Because the very first step towards weakening the power of anger and afterwards getting rid of it altogether, first step, is to see that it's coming from outside. And do not let it in at all. Refuse anger from letting it come inside, and then refuse to give any expression to that act. See, what are we all looking for in life? We're all looking for happiness. We're all looking for success. Have you ever heard of anybody who is a basically angry person and who has reached great pinnacles of success. It is not possible to get success if I am an angry person. Why? Because I'll keep removing my friends from me. I will keep removing people who love me from my circle of love. Once the mother was asked, you know, she was asked a question that, mother, right now, whenever we are angry or I am jealous or whatever, I have a problem, we come to you and you point it out to us. But once you are gone, mother, how will we know whether I'm doing the right thing or I'm doing the wrong thing? So mother said, you know, you have the thermometer within you. And she said that every time a negative emotion wells up in your being, means that you are not on the path towards sadhana, towards becoming a higher being. Every time a negative emotion is seen, you have to kick it out. And that is the thermometer inside you. So Sudev Nair says, meditation is a good way to get rid of anger. Yes, of course. We have to try out many things to be able to get rid of our anger. Pranvi Shahi is saying that Lord Shankar was full of anger. No, he was not full of anger. Lord Shankara was very calm inside. What he showed outside was something he showed, but that was not his nature. He did not become the anger. He was the epitome of quietude and silence and bliss. He was always living in bliss. Yes, ma'am.
Arthak Agarwal probably is talking of conscious anger. So yes, I'll read out the entire thing, the context as well.
Okay.
The food becomes more tasty when hungry. That is when we have less, then we enjoy even small things.
Huh.
Is anger important to increase the effect of forgiveness? And he says he's asking this question as everything has importance in the universe.
Okay.
And then later he writes, anger is like an infinite well that can only be observed and contained but not emptied.
I think we'll have to read. It's a long question with many things in it.
Yeah. So let's segregate it. First,
yes.
Is anger important to increase the effect of forgiveness?
No. You cannot increase the effect of forgiveness by becoming angry. Because how will you forgive when you're angry? You've increased your own anger and you've increased the distance between the person with whom your voice, your love and your forgiveness has to be increased. You have to decrease that space. Every time I get angry, I increase the distance between me and the person. So how will forgiveness come? So I'm sorry, anger cannot help to increase the forgiveness inside you. Yes. And the second part?
Second part is that anger is like an infinite well.
Yes.
You can observe it, contain it, but you cannot empty it.
So, if we think that anger is inside me, then to get rid of anger will be very difficult. And that is not even true. Inside me, there is a well of joy. There is a well of bliss. The Sat, Chit and Anand is inside me. And we have a well of bliss and joy and ananda inside us. Anger is something that is coming from outside. And if I am tuned to the bliss inside, I will not catch the waves because my mind is tuned to the higher. It is like a radio, Sarthak. You cannot catch the negative vibrations. You see, there are people who are so contained within their joy, inner being, that nothing, there's no flurry in their being. They're always in a state of bliss. The anger is not within you. It's not like a well, but once you have allowed the anger to come inside you and you have identified yourself with anger, then it is like a bottomless pit. Then you don't know, because your whole buddhi is gone. There is bewilderment. What did the Gita shlok tell you? What were the different stages? There is attachment and there is desire, and that leads to anger. And with anger comes bewilderment. This is the time you get into a pit, a well. There is bewilderment, there is perplexity, there is confusion, and then there is loss of memory. You've forgotten what you were really playing football for, or what you are in the class, why are you studying? You've forgotten, you only want, I should come first. So that confusion, all that happens when we have allowed the anger to come inside us. Anger is not my natural state of being. My natural state of being is bliss, is joy. Right?
Ma'am, yes. Yes, Artha. That, like when we do, when a poor person doesn't have any food, and then when he receives even a biscuit or even a cream biscuit, then he becomes very happy. But if a high class person eats a cream biscuit, he will not be that much happy.
Okay.
So my point was that if no one in the world would have anger, or the anger aspect would not exist in the world, then when the opposite of anger, if we consider forgiveness, when everybody will be doing forgiveness only, then the value of forgiveness, that when you do something wrong, you are forgiven. So the value of forgiveness will decrease. But if anger is there, then when people forgive, the value will be there. So people will want to forgive. But if anger aspect is not there, then the value of someone forgiving, or when someone forgives, it will not be there.
So we don't forgive for getting a value out of it, right? We don't forgive, we don't love so that we can get a value out of it. We love or we forgive because we want to become a better human being. And forgiveness is a concept which gives me a kind of a pride. I have forgiven, right? Why should I, who am I to forgive? I should be able to offer that anger inside my higher being and to be able to understand that why, there must be some reason why that person got angry with me. And I offer it to my higher being and I say, grow love and compassion in me. That love and compassion has to be grown in me. Forgiveness generally, Sarthak, leads to a sense of superiority in me. I have been able to forgive him. You know, that I grows when we forgive. But when we grow in love and we pass that love on to the other person, then the I doesn't grow. Right?
So Palak Bhandari from 7B, yes. She yes. says, sometimes people provoke us to express our anger. Huh. And if we don't express it, it keeps irritating us and it remains inside us. So how to overcome that?
It will stay inside us. The anger will stay. See, if a person is provoking us and continuously provoking us, but I have my sense of understanding, my sense of discretion that I am being provoked. Now, if I identify with the provocation and we allow the provocation to enter into my mind, it depends on my mind. Where is my mind tuned? And is my mind conscious or is my mind unconscious? If my mind is conscious, it will understand that this is a provocation and it will take the provocation. We are giving the answer towards the end of this talk, that the provocation we understand and we put it into an Anjali and we talk to our higher self and we say, you know what? A, B is just provoking me. And I am conscious. I'm not going to flow into unconscious anger. I'm conscious that I'm being provoked. I take this provocation and I put it into that sea of delight inside. And I say, oh higher self, oh psychic being, I offer this provocation to you. Om Agnim Mire. You lead the way. You become Purohita. You lead the way. How should I deal with the person who's provoking me? This is the difference between conscious anger and unconscious anger. When I'm conscious, I'm being provoked. I will be conscious. I will take that provocation like a flaming arrow and take that and pour it into that sea of delight and ananda inside and say, you lead the way. You tell me how should I respond. If I have reacted already, then I've gotten into anger. But if I respond, then slowly from inside, there will be an answer how to be able to do it. Yes, Arya Mishra is saying, then it will become we instead of I. Then it will be we. We will together deal with this problem. Right?
Is there any importance of anger? This is a question that has been asked. Is there any importance of anger?
The only importance of anger that I can see is that it makes us conscious of my mind being tuned to negative forces. And the minute I become conscious of it, let the mind start tuning itself to positive thoughts. And the best way to do that is to keep connecting with the psychic being inside, because it is a pool of positivity. And that is so easy because it's right there within us, so close to us. There is no advantage at all of anger. Cannot be.
So Shashi Dubé asks that there are times when we reach that point of anger and we are about to express it. At that time, it becomes very difficult to control.
Yes.
Not instantly meditate. So what to do in such situations?
Well, if we have allowed the anger to enter into our being, and I have already identified with it. Shashi ma'am, the main thing is, am I still conscious or have I become unconscious? If I become unconscious, it will flow out of me. But if I'm still even a little bit conscious, or maybe I have flown in anger, I have said things that I didn't want to say, and then I become conscious. The minute I become conscious, the minute I tune into the psychic being, the minute I tune into positive forces, I calm down. Because I don't want that dwarf to become so large and larger than me. I calm down and I do not react. I first become calm and then I respond. And I say to the other person an apology if I'm able to. If I'm not able to say it verbally, we can give an inner apology. My inner being, my soul is always in communication with all souls. So from my inner being, what is called in Sanskrit paschatap, there can be a paschatap, there can be an inner apology to the person and to myself, because I have allowed a negative emotion, a negative force to enter into my being, and I've allowed my inner being, my physical being, all of it to be polluted by that negativity. And we have to get rid of it as soon as possible. I hope I've answered your question.
Ridhima Rana, she says, you are punished by your anger more than you are punished for your anger.
Very beautiful. Very beautiful, Ridhima. Can you show your hand? I'd love to see which one is Ridhima, a digital hand. We are punished by the anger more than for the anger. Very, very true, Ridhima.
So that is how we began the session, nonetheless. Uh-huh. He has taken a challenge of 100 days of sketching, and in which every day he has to make a new artwork. So in the morning, he is quite tense about what he'll do that particular day, and everything around him irritates him.
Oh my God.
Situation into which he's drawn himself.
Okay. So Samyak, you have taken a 100-day challenge. Did somebody propose the challenge to you, or did you put it for yourself? Did you bring it to yourself?
He's written, I have taken it up.
You have taken up the challenge. Now, the challenge can be taken up from the mind and the ego. I have taken up a challenge. I am going to face it and I'm going to win in the challenge, right? But has there been anything inside you that is in a state of offering? If that same I starts going into a state of offering, that I offer to thee, O Lord, I offer to thee, O my sweet psychic being, I offer to thee, and let the circumstances become such that I am in a state of positivity. Please be in a state of offering. Art is a very beautiful medium, and art should only be able to lead you towards more and more refinement in your being. It should not be able to lead you to anger. When art is leading you to anger, it is not art that is leading you to anger. It is the I in me that is saying, I have taken up the challenge. And if my mother says, come, your food is ready, and that's taking me away from the art, then I get angry. That I has to be in a state of offering and not in the state of pride. Okay? Whoever is the one who's taken on the art challenge. It's a very beautiful challenge you've taken up. And I saw you sketching even while we were seeing in the gallery view. Very beautiful sketches. Please continue to do them. But be in a little state of offering. Not just I. Okay? So, where are we? The mind is like a radio. And when the mind is tuned to negative emotions, to negativity, maybe desire, maybe pride, maybe attachment, maybe ambition, maybe ego, maybe disgust, maybe expectation. Expectation is one of the greatest problems that we have. Expectation. I expect this. I want this. And maybe it could be any one of these. But when the mind is tuned to negativity, it will catch on negative vibrations, it will subjectify, and it will seem like anger from within or any other negative form which will rise up. So what do we need to do? We need to recognize what is it that is negative force in me and consciously transform and work towards the opposite of it. Now, if anger is my problem, the opposite of it is not forgiveness. The opposite of it is love. It's compassion. When I grow love and compassion inside me, the force of anger becomes weaker and weaker and weaker. Suppose my problem is desire, greed, selfishness. And each one of us knows our problems. None of us are such that we are not aware of what my problem is. If my problem is greed, selfishness, desire, I want for myself. I want only for myself. Then what do I need to grow inside me? I need to grow the capacity to be able to share, the capacity to be able to give. You have to work on the opposite of the negative force. And when that force starts increasing, this negative force starts getting transformed. Because even the negativity is a force. Like a river. Now the river is flowing towards this direction. But if I want to change the direction, it's the same force. But we can change the direction by putting a dam and change the direction. So the force of the negative force has to be allowed consciously. Consciously we change the direction towards its exact opposite. Right? Very simple example. There are people in our families who love eating pan masala. And now their wives will keep saying, mat khao, pan masala mat khao. It's going to be so bad. It is cancerous. Now, instead of suppressing the eating of pan masala, if we substitute it with starting to eat sauf or some mouth freshener, slowly and slowly, we substitute one for the other. Then slowly and steadily, the habit starts getting loosened and the habit starts changing. We have to loosen, we have to open. You know, we are like lots of threads and all the threads have been tied into a knot. That's what we are. All our emotions have been tied into a knot. Now slowly we have to untangle that knot. You have to notice this is the emotion that is inside me. And I untie that knot and I bring it to its exact opposite. The negative, I change it towards the exact opposite. This is why Jaipuria School's aim and motto is conscious transformation. Instead of trying to suppress anger, we should focus on inculcating positive qualities of love and compassion in us. Right? Similarly, any other negative quality that we have, we have to just work on the opposite and slowly and steadily, very, very delicately, we have to untie the knot and work towards the opposite. That is the way. So, what do you feel is the method of weakening the power of anger in our nature? We have gone through the whole thing and we'll go through the whole thing step by step by step. Sarthak Mishra is saying, ma'am, when someone has done something extremely wrong with us, then is expressing anger correct or wrong? Even when somebody has done something really wrong with us, expressing anger will not help to change the situation. It can never help to change the situation, can never help to transform the situation. What can help is to be able to connect with the higher self within and offer that pain. But there will be a lot of pain when somebody has unjustly harmed us or hurt us, and it is absolutely unjust. But by getting angry on him, nothing will change, because everybody always tries to defend themselves and always try to show that I was right. So it doesn't help. It is always best to send emotions of love to that person and continuously pray and pray and be in a state which is calm and composed, because only when we are calm and composed do the higher thoughts, do they get an expression into our being. But when we are in a state of flurry, we will not be able to get the higher inspirations. And we do not want to be ordinary children, do we? Ordinary person would be provoked, or some injustice has been done to an ordinary person, and the person will go out into a flurry of anger, fight it out, and think that I will argue it out. Argument has never helped. A proper discussion can help, but a proper discussion can only take place when the other person is also ready to discuss in a very civil, in a calm manner. Right?
Kanika ma'am writes, is it justified to get angry at something which is morally or ethically wrong?
No. Anger can never help a situation. If somebody is desiring to be immoral, unethical, by telling him it doesn't help. Sri Aurobindo has said there are three forms of education. The lowest form of education is instruction. When I instruct, you were immoral, or what you are thinking is unethical, it doesn't help. The second form of teaching or education is by setting an example, if the other person is ready to take the example. And the highest form of education is when I am able to influence. When does influence work? Influence works when you are working from your higher self. When you are working from your higher self, your presence is able to uplift the other person's thoughts. The other person is uplifted because your presence is connected to the highest self within. Then your presence is able to uplift people. Right? Anger cannot help, Kanika ma'am, even if the other person is doing injustice or cruelty or something wrong. Yes, Shivani?
Ma'am, are there better and worse ways to respond to one's own anger?
Are there better or worse ways? The worst way is to show expression of the anger. A better way is to become conscious that I am angry and hold that anger inside me and look at it. And look at it and say, I don't want you. I want to transform you. I am angry with that person, but I need to transform this into love, not forgiveness. Love. I want to turn this into love for the person who has hurt me. And it is a possibility. There are many people who have done it, and Jaipurian students and teachers will be able to do it. We will all be able to do it. It is not an impossibility. Right? That is that we just turn it towards becoming conscious of it. And when we become conscious of it, we say, I want to throw you out or transform you. We can't throw it out because it is entered into our being, but we can transform it. Transforming it into love and compassion. It just feels so good. You will feel good about yourself. That is what's important, right? And in the long run, when you become grown-up people who are doing a job, running a business, in the government, running the country, then if you are in a place of anger, you cannot be successful. But if you are in a space which is a space full of love and compassion and the higher thoughts, believe you me, there is nobody who can come in between you and success. It just depends. Your emotional intelligence is very, very important. And this is the time to grow into our emotional intelligence. Become conscious of it. Right? Yes, ma'am.
Aligned with this is, can we suppress or stop someone else's anger? From Nilay Gupta.
Nilay, we cannot suppress anybody else's anger. We cannot stop anybody else's anger. But what we can do is, while that person is angry and I am not angry, I am conscious, I am hearing him, what I can do is allow that anger to enter into the psychic being and say, I pray for you, and keep sending prayers to that person. Pray for that person. Pray for his growing into love and compassion. Send love and compassion for him, because he or she really needs love and compassion. This is the only thing that you can do. You cannot stop another person's anger. You can pray for that person. Yes?
Akriti says, is delay the greatest remedy for danger, for anger?
Yes, it's a very beautiful question and very beautifully spoken. That delay, what we call a pause, that when we feel the anger, we pause, we look at it, and we see the anger is entering into me, and I become conscious of it, and then I offer it to the higher being inside, and I transform it into its opposite. That can only happen when you have used the tool of delay, when you've used the tool that the Buddhists call pause.
I think we need to unmute Sudev, writing good things, and he wishes to speak.
Mom, the emotion of anger, mom, can provide mom tremendous energy. Mom, to mom prove things and mom change things for good.
You think that the energy of anger can change things for good, Sudev?
Mom, sometimes. Mom, if we don't have mom any mom fault, and mom other one mom scold us or mom gets angry,
then does it help? Does it help you to change when you've not made a mistake and somebody's gotten angry with you?
Yeah, I think. Mom, because mom, it is very powerful, mom, and if it is for mom right, mom, it causes good.
Okay, Sudev, I beg to differ here. We can have different points of view, but anger can never be a good tool to bring a positive change. If the same thing is said in a very loving fashion and explained nicely, the science of it, why should you study just now? Why should you not go out and play just now? When it is explained in a beautiful manner, it will be much more effective than if somebody has just shouted at you and told you, no, your cricket bat has been banned and I've locked it and now you just have to study. That doesn't work. because it can ban you from playing cricket that minute, but it has not explained to your heart why you should be studying or whatever other reason.
Yes.
So anger is not a good tool, not at all.
And Sudev, you've also related it with disease, right? So on one side, you've written that it causes diseases. And yes, you mentioned cancer there. So you already know what it leads you to.
Excuse me, Mom, can you please tell again?
I'll tell you. So when you have negative emotions, and you've written it yourself, Sudev, that when people harbor negative emotions inside themselves, they get diseases inside them. They can be psychosomatic diseases. They can be physical diseases. They can be any sorts of diseases because that negative emotion is being harbored inside. Just like I told you, if I've eaten food, it has to be evacuated within 24 hours. If I've drunk water in 4 hours, it has to be evacuated. Otherwise, I get sick. Suppose in your kitchen, a lot of cooking is being done. And with the cooking, there's a lot of waste material that's thrown out. Now, if that's not thrown out and it accumulates, it will cause diseases in the home, right? Similarly, these negative things, when they are kept inside us, negative emotions like anger, depression, fear, pride, ego, all these cause psychosomatic or other physical diseases inside us. Yes?
Yes.
Roopsi ma'am asks, is there a difference between aggression and anger?
Anger's worst form becomes aggression. So when I allow anger in the beginning and then I become that anger can turn into aggression. For instance, that example that I gave about that child who's playing football, he started by playing for fun, but it turned into his attachment to becoming the man of the match, towards becoming the hero of the match. And then when he started trying to shoot the goals, somebody dribbled the ball away. Somebody blocked the goalkeeper could catch the ball when it was thrown. Now that anger turned into aggression. And when it turned into aggression, usne tangri mari. Usne kya kiya? Usne kisi ko trip kar diya. Kisi ko push kar diya. That same desire led to anger turned into aggression. Right? So we have to be careful when it's entering into our being. That's the time we have to become careful. Conscious transformation.
It is said that when one is angry, one speaks the truth. So,
not necessarily. When one is angry, whatever one has harbored inside, in the mind, one would have harbored that person is not nice. And you've harbored it and you've harbored it and you've harbored it. And when you're angry, what has been registered inside the mind as if it's a truth and it will come out. But it's not necessarily truth. It can be what you have fed into your mind and what has been registered in your mind. That. Yes?
Yuvraj Singh says that sometimes elders get angry at us for no fault of ours.
Okay.
What to do at that time?
What to do at that time? First of all, the adults may be getting angry because they really love you and care for you. And they want the best for you. But they don't know how to control their anger because their attachment to your success, your good health, your good marks, they become attached to it. And when they become attached to it, they have a desire that my son or my daughter has to do the best or has to eat the best food, has to be the healthiest child in the block. And that attachment of theirs leads them to anger. So first of all, understand that it's coming out of some love and sweetness towards you. At least understand that much. And then, because you are conscious, hopefully you are conscious. If you are conscious at that time, then you can consciously have a dialogue with your parent, your mother or father or grandparents and say that I have understood. I will try to change whatever you have told me to do, but do not flow into unconscious anger. Do not let their anger enter into you so that you start identifying with anger and you also become angry. That will really spoil the situation. Try to avoid that. And of course, there is the psychic being inside us. And we are becoming conscious of that psychic being. We are becoming conscious of the soul. We are becoming conscious of the higher self in us. So when my parent has gotten angry on me, I can take that anger, put it in my Anjali, and offer it to the psychic being. And ask the psychic being for guidance. You come forward. You just come forth and lead. Become the Purohita. That is also, that is the most important way to deal with the anger of parents or anybody else.
So Ranjita Batra ma'am says, is it right to move away from the company of people who keep provoking us to react?
In the beginning, it is good to move away from company who provokes us. Later on, when we become strong, when we are able to deal with all the negativities of the world, then we are able to deal with them in a most beautiful manner without any reactions, where the response comes out from the highest part of my being. But until then, if it is possible to move out of that circle of negativity, it is best to move out. Sometimes when you are meant to grow, God creates such circumstances that you are yourself led away from any company that may lead to a negative emotion in you. It may not be the fault of the company. It may be your own fault. But you are led away from that situation to grow as a being.
Satviki Shukla and Maitri, they have the same question, that sometimes I start crying. Actually, I'm angry, but I'm not able to explain my point of view.
Okay.
So when someone misjudges me, what should I do at that time?
See, all questions have the same answer. Yeah. All questions have the same answer. That let us go to that who is within us, who is there right in the center of my being, who is the higher being, who is Ananda, who is joy, just pure joy. And when I cry, it's because there is something in me that has been hurt very badly. And I take that hurt. And where will I get the Ananda when I pour that hurt into the pool of joy, pool of highest Ananda? Then, and I take a dip inside that Ananda, that when I come out of that dip, 2 seconds, just 2 seconds, you close your eyes and you let your tears flow, but you let them all flow into that pool. And you ask that pool of Ananda, that higher being, Om Agnim Ile Purohitam Yajnasya, lead the way. And everything changes. It doesn't take long. It's only that we have to be in a habit of constantly, constantly, constantly connecting with it, that it becomes a habit. Then that habit becomes a constant connection. It becomes like a hotline between you and your psychic being.
That's Sanjeev Pandeji's question too.
Okay, then after that we will...
Yeah. One question by Sparsh Kaushik, which is slightly different. In Mahabharata, Lord Krishna got angry and picked up the wheel. Was that right?
Lord Krishna never gets angry. Lord Krishna always wants that whoever is his bhakta, his speech, his prana, his vow must come and must come true. And because Bhishma Pitama had vowed that I will make you pick up your weapons, even though you have vowed that you will never pick up weapons in the Mahabharata. So he let his own his own prana, his own vow, he broke that vow so that he could make Bhishma Pitama's vow come true. And that is why he picked up that wheel and he showed anger. There was no anger in Lord Krishna. He only posed anger.
क्या क्रोध की तीव्रता को कम करने का स्थाई तरीका एक स्वस्थ भोजन भी है मैम जय
वेरी गुड जया वेरी नाइस जया व्हेन वी ईट बैलेंस मील्स व्हेन वी डू एक्सरसाइजेस व्हाट वी डिड इन द फर्स्ट डे एम ऑफ स्पिरिचुअल रिट्रीट व्हेन वी कॉन्शियसली लुक आफ्टर आवर फिजिकल बॉडी इन ऑल द फॉर्म्स दैट वी कैन then there is a balance in the body and then this krodha cannot become so heavy on me, it cannot take hold of me. Definitely food, exercise, pranayam, cleanliness, hygiene, enough hours of sleep, all these are very important tools to maintain a balance of the body. And what is anger but an imbalance? Anger is an imbalance. And when we similarly, consciously, what we did in the first day, consciously we look at all our vital being and all the points that I had told you on the vital being, how to bring about a balance in my vital being. Go over those points again and consciously try and grow all that nature should grow in you, all those points, similarly the mental being. How we have to grow calm in our being. How we have to maintain silence in our being, in our mental being. Concentration. We are able to remove negative thought when it comes to us. Instantly we are able to kick it out. Sri Aurobindo said, kick it. Just kick it. The negative thought comes, kick it. Don't allow it entry. Make that a habit. That is mental growth. That the mental being is growing. So when we do all of those, then we are able to get a balance in our being and the anger also will be taken care of. You're right, Jaya. I hope I've answered your question, Jaya.
So Sarthak Mishra says, people like Maharishi, they also got angry. So were they justified and they meditated too? So was that justified? How is this possible?
Meditation is not the only way, the one and the only way by which one can get over all the problems. Meditation is one of them. But did anybody say that Rishi Durvasa was the best Rishi? Do people talk about Rishi Durvasa? Whenever they talk about Rishi Durvasa, they say he had anger. And he immediately could. So nobody talks well of Rishi Durvasa because everybody was scared of him. But is that what we want in our lives? Do we want people to love us because they are scared of us? Nobody wants that. So we have to use those examples of Rishis from whom we can learn, who we want to emulate, who we want to become like. And there were many, many such Rishis. Right?
I think we can.
Rishi Dadichi, Sarthak Mishra. Very true. Rishi Yagyavalk. Beautiful. There's so many Rishis. Thank you, Sattviki. So, now, what is the method? Let's go over it point by point by point, stage by stage by stage. What is the method of weakening the power of anger in my nature? On the basis of this discussion that we've had, let us go through the three stages of weakening the power of anger in my being. Believe clearly that the movement of anger is coming from outside, from the adverse forces of the universal nature, right? All the negative forces are outside us. All the positive forces are outside us. If my mind, which is like a radio, if it is tuned to positive emotions, instantly it will only catch the positive emotions. So believe clearly and wholly that all these forces of negativity are outside me and it is very easy for me to kick it. Just kick it. It's much easier to kick it when I know it's coming from outside. This is stage one. Now, suppose it has entered into my being. Then stage two is that I become conscious of it. I become conscious of the anger. And I refuse all expression of anger in act, speech, and thought. It has entered and I'm conscious. If it has entered and if I'm conscious. And when I'm conscious, then I try to increase my willpower to send it away without giving it any expression. Any expression. I know that this is easier said than done. But for whom is the spiritual retreat? Is it meant for weak people? Is the path of spirituality meant for weak people? No. This path is for those who are strong, who want to become conscious individuals, who want to grow out of their negativity, want to grow into the positivity. So they increase their willpower. They look at their anger and they increase their willpower. If they've already gotten angry, they increase the love and emotion, the emotion of love and compassion in them, and pass it on either vocally or silently to the person with whom they've gotten angry. Even the silent communication. In fact, the silent communication works much faster and much better than the verbal communication. This is stage two. Now, what is stage three? Deep within us, there is another consciousness, our true inner being, our higher self, which is our real self. Become aware of it and offer the negativity to this higher self for conscious transformation. Should we keep the slide on? Would you like to meditate on it? Please keep the slide on for 15 seconds. We will meditate on that higher self, our real self, our psychic being within us. So, someone has shot a flaming arrow of anger at you. Either you become conscious of it right there before it has entered your being and you've kicked it. But if you were not conscious and that anger, that flaming arrow of anger or injustice or whatever else, it has come inside you and then you are conscious of it. When you are conscious of it, you look at the anger inside you. You see it, but you don't give it expression. You let it flow through your body and you bring it into your Anjali and you pour it into the higher being, into the psychic being, into our soul. And we ask the soul to guide. Or else we have already given expression to it. Then to when we become conscious. Because till I'm not conscious, nothing can be done. If unconsciously I'm going on spewing out anger from me, nothing can be done at that time. But later when I become conscious, I come back, center myself where I really am. Center myself with who I really am. I am the psychic being. I am going to identify myself with the psychic being. And in that psychic being, there is a presence which is full of light, full of delight, full of joy, full of ananda. And I am a natural inheritor of that ananda. Because vayam amritasya putraha. We are children of that. We are children of that immortal self. We are that immortal self. We have a right to that ananda. And when that anger can't possess my mind, it flees. It goes away. And then we respond from the quiet strength of this higher being, this true inner self within myself. Tell me, dear students, isn't this absolutely doable? No, 1 minute. 1 minute. I'm asking the children a question. Can you stop sharing? Tell me, my dear students, is this possible or not possible? What do you feel? Shanaya says yes, ma'am. Sarthak Mishra says yes. Will we all consciously? Yes. Akriti says yes. Devleena says yes. So everybody, most many people are saying yes. Very beautiful.
We can raise the thumb.
Fully, yes. We can show our... Raise your thumb, my dear. If you feel it is possible. Yes. Let's see some digital thumbs. Right? Very nice. So nice. So, when we function from anger, when we function from anger, which has come from outside, the outside creates our inside. And my inside also gets all in a flurry. It gets upset. It gets imbalanced. And the outside starts reflecting from our inside, which is not fair. Because my inside is very beautiful. My inside is the psychic being, that light, the light of the soul. And that is who I really am. So when I function from love, which is the nature of the psychic being, then my inside creates a beautiful aura around me, creates my outside, right? When we function in anger, our outside creates our inside and our inside gets imbalanced. But when we function in love, our inside creates our outside. So let us, Jaipurians, can we show the last slide? And then we can take some questions. Let us, Jaipurians, become the sun-eyed children of a marvelous dawn. The sun-eyed children of a marvelous dawn, citizens of tomorrow and centers of light, whose presence will create increasing circles of wisdom, strength, harmony, and perfection. This is what us Jaipurians have to become. Centers of light. Centers which will emanate wisdom. Centers which will emanate strength, emanate harmony, and emanate perfection. Yes? So if there are any questions or any suggestions or anything else, you'd like to say something, please go ahead.
So Shivansh, he had asked, what is construction anger? Perhaps he means constructive anger.
Shivansh, I don't think there is any anger that is constructive. Anger cannot be constructive. Because anger is when you lose your balance. There can be an anger which you are having a drama of. That you feel that if I show a little bit of anger, maybe the person will move. That is a show of anger, not that you have gotten into anger. And sometimes that is necessary, but at this age, it is better not to get into the show of anger, because there is that fear that when we get into the show of anger, we may become the anger. So we have to be very careful. What Sri Krishna did when he picked up the wheel, it was a show of anger. He was not angry. Yes? And there is no constructive anger.
Yeah. So Moshami, she's from Jaipur. She says, Sri Parshuram, how should we see his anger? What does that teach us? How to stop the unconscious anger when there is constant provocation by someone known to you? And we cannot avoid that person.
We cannot avoid most of the situations that happen in our life. Who is this? Whose question is
Moshami.
It?
Moshami.
So Moshami, most people at this age specifically, we cannot avoid. But to be able to deal with the anger in the right manner is what is more important. And to be able to deal with anger in a conscious manner, that is what is important. And that is what we've spoken about today. That we have to be able to be conscious of what we are hearing and how it is being processed by our mind. Is the mind flowing into what it has heard and reacting to it? Or is the mind being able to process it? Is the mind being able to see what is the other's point of view? Is the mind being able to take hold of what the other person has said and offer it to the higher self and ask for the guidance and let that guidance flow forward, has the mind dealt with it in a conscious manner? That is most important. Have I been able to answer your question, Moshmi? Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so this
is... Priti Singh is saying for every minute...
You are angry. You that 60 seconds of happiness.
You lose 60 seconds of happiness. How beautiful. Because you've moved. You move from that source. When you're angry, you move from that source of happiness, which is your psychic being. So, no. Yes, you're right. Very, very right, Akriti. Beautifully said.
Aditya Mishra, is it helpful to feel guilt and regret because we've already done the deed and cannot do anything about it?
Okay.
Like so, Suryaputra
Karma. It's good to feel guilt and regret. It is good to feel regret because only when we feel regret, we go into the stage inside our being when we want to deal with what mistake we have done. If you are not conscious of the mistake that we have done, we'll never try to repair it. So it is important to feel that regret and then to take the right steps. That is important, not to stay inside that circle of guilt. Just by staying in the circle of guilt, you will again attract negative emotions. The negativity will catch hold of the mind. The radio will pick up the negative emotion because even guilt is a negative emotion. Don't stick with it. Work on it and do what is necessary to do. Apologize, but apologize from the center of your being, not just from the mind. Let it be a deep apology. Let it be an internal apology. Let love flow from your heart towards the person who you have hurt with your anger. Let that first happen from your inner being and then from your outer being, apologize to that person. But don't live in guilt, because guilt and regret are negative emotions.
What are the physical effects of getting angry?
Beg your pardon?
What are the physical effects of getting angry?
The physical effect of getting angry, first of all, is that anger leads to an imbalance in me. My mind becomes imbalanced. My vital being, the emotions go into imbalance. And if the anger is really strong, the physical being also bears the brunt of it. So that anger can lead to all kinds of imbalances, unhappiness, lack of joy, and even illness if it becomes a habit, a continuous habit.
So you will ask, what do you mean, what do you understand by forgive and forget?
These are platitudes that the West has come up with, but I sincerely tell you that forgiveness is a tool which will give you pride. It is better to use the tool of love and compassion. Forgiveness will definitely make you feel so proud of yourself. I have forgiven him. That doesn't help. Send love to that person. And if at all you want to forgive, let the I get dissolved into the higher self. Let the I not become too large. If that is the only way to forget the incident, then let the I not become too large. Be conscious of the I which forgives. It is not I who forgave, it is he, the larger divine, who forgives all of us, all the time.
Kartike Chaudhary says, are there two types of anger, tamasic and sattvic?
There are three types of anger. There is a tamasic anger, there is a rajasic anger, there is a sattvic anger. The tamasic anger is one in which one just gets into the anger and one uses the most obscene and the worst kind forms of words that one is using because one has flown into that, one has become the anger and one doesn't know what one is doing. The rajasic anger is when one is in that space where one want something better to happen, or one is full of desires and one wants the desires to be fulfilled, and then the rajasic anger comes out because one's desires are not being fulfilled. And sattvic anger is when one wants, like parents who want something good for us and we are not able to do it, and then they get angry because they want us to become better than we are. But still it is anger, and anger is not a good space to be in.
Adrika Agarwal, she had asked that sometimes it happens we misunderstand a person and we try to express it, we try to explain it, but the person does not allow us to do so, and that makes us angry. So how can we overcome such a situation? Adrika Agarwal.
So can you repeat the question, please?
Yeah. There are times when we misunderstand someone and we later realize this. We try to explain it to the person, but the person does not allow us to explain. So that annoys us. How to overcome such an anger?
So to begin with, we have said that we have misunderstood the other person.
Yeah.
So obviously when I'm trying to explain to the person, he's not understanding and not allowing me to explain because he knows that we have misunderstood him. He is not wrong. I have misunderstood him. So that is why he is not allowing us. And when he is not allowing us, my desire, remember always the different stages. It begins from desire. It begins from an attachment. What is the attachment here? To be able to recognize the attachment, that I want him to understand my point of view and he should be able to hear me out. So that attachment is a first knot. We talked about knots, that there is a knot inside my being. The first knot we have to be able to identify before it turns into another knot. And if we are able to open it right there, my attachment is he should be able to understand my point of view. That is the first knot. If we stop it right there, then we stop arguing. Again, argument never leads to anything healthy. If at all, it should be a healthy discussion. But as I said earlier, a healthy discussion is only possible when both the parties want a healthy discussion. But if one party wants a healthy discussion and the other party wants to fight, it's better not to argue, not to fight, but like Krishna, keep quiet and sit down till the anger actually becomes smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, just according to that story. Have I been able to answer your question?
Ma'am, Ridhima Pandey, she asks, what is the best possible way to release anger? There are some other children who've sent messages that anger does need an expression.
Anger,
what is the best possible way? Anger does need an expression at times. So what is the best possible way of expressing?
Then if you do need to express very badly, take a piece of paper, take a diary and write it all out. It helps to be able to come out with it in paper and then tear the paper into shreds and throw it away. That is one of the ways by which you can let the anger out and yet not harm yourself by spoiling your relations with someone else with whom you're angry. And you still need an expression, write it down. Let it come out. Let it flow out. Similarly for hurt. When I'm really hurt and I don't know any other better method than to express it, then it is best to write it down. Write it down. I am hurt by this. I have always taken resort to writing letters to God. And it has helped me over years and years of my life. Would just write letters to God. I would write my feelings. I would pour out my heart. People write their diary, whatever you want to do. But that is one of the methods of expressing and yet not hurting your relationships.
I just wish to read out what Kavish is saying. A beautiful
yes.
From a class 7 child. Anger does not solve or build anything, but it only destroys everything.
Very true, Kavish. Very, very true. Beautifully said. Anger cannot build. Anger cannot lead to anything good. Very nice, Kavish.
So Roopsi ma'am says, throw it in the let go pond.
Yes, we have a let it go pond in our school. All we need to do is just throw it into the let it go pond. Right? So, any other comments? Otherwise, we can end with 15-20 seconds of silence. Kavish says, thank you.
And Sarthak Mishra says, anger is equal to destruction, not creation.
Very good, Sarthak. Anger is equal to destruction, not creation. Very good. Very good. This is our way of clapping, right? Very good. Any other? The throw it in the let it go pond was very nice. So should we end the session now with the 15 seconds of silence? All right. This session will flow very nicely into the next session, which is stages of equanimity. How do we reach that stage where we are in a stage of equanimity, a stage of samatha? Because that is what Sri Krishna has said, that come into the space of samatha. When you are in the stage of samatha, in the highest stage of samatha, anger will not flow from you. You are neither here nor there. You are in one calm space, right? Sarthak Mishra. Okay, thank you, Sarthak. Thank you. So I hope to see you all in the next session. Krodh.
Had the silence, then we wish to end the session. But Kartike Chaudhary says, if someone obstructs and disturbs us in the way of Bhagavad Prapti,
Achha.
Or in the way of being the perfect instrument of God, and that makes us angry, then is that fine? Is that acceptable?
If we are on the way to Bhagavad Prapti, if we are on the way to becoming as perfect as the Divine Himself, then anger cannot be the method. It can definitely not be the method, because Bhagavad Prapti means I'm becoming more perfect than I am, and more perfect than I am, and more perfect than I am. And if I'm resorting to anger, we have slipped down. So there has to be another method. Now somebody is coming on the way, we have to find out the reasons why that person is coming in the way. Have a healthy discussion with that person. It could be a parent who feels that you should spend more time in studying than you're spending in the Bhagavad Gita. Or the parent may be saying that you must get up in the morning and go for sports because your body has to become more perfect. Even if you have a few lesser minutes of meditation, it may be that also, right? Otherwise, why will anybody come in the way of Bhagavad Prapti? Only a parent who feels that we have to become better, a better physical being, a better emotional being, a better mental being. And that parent may be stopping you from some of the practices that are taking a lot of your time. So have a healthy discussion with whosoever it may be. Because if you're on the path of Bhagavad Prapti, you will be able to have a healthy, calm, soothing discussion and discuss it out. Have I answered your question, my dear? Kartike says yes.
Yes.
Okay, my dear. Yes, ma'am. Are there more questions or suggestions or comments? Or
I think we can wrap it up.
Okay. So see you all those who are coming for the afternoon session on equanimity, how we can reach this samta where there'll be no anger. So come on, show me thumbs up, all those who are coming for the session in the afternoon. Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Bye.